Oh, like I always say, lucky you, another fantastic episode of Weasel Radio. My name is Owen Murphy. I'm in Shoreline, Washington, through the magic of technology, across the inner tube, the one, the only, in Madison, Wisconsin. His name, Ben Weasel. Ben, how are you?
I'm well. How are you?
You're not well. You've been shoveling all morning long, and you're tired.
No, I haven't been shoveling. I've been using the snowblower, and that was so many hours ago, I don't even... Yeah, I was at 5:40. I'm tired.
Yeah. Right now, we're listening to Night Flights by the Walker Brothers from their last record. We played this at the end of yesterday's show, and after I played it for you, you had a lot of interesting things to say about Scott Walker and disparaging things to say about other singers. And tell me what you, as we kind of play the song underneath us, tell me what you think of it. You can tell us now.
I'm listening. Anyway, the song is obviously really dated. It doesn't hold up well as a song, but the vocal is terrific. I mean, I guess is what Scott Walker was always known for. I mean, probably like you, or maybe not. I was only very distantly aware of the Walker Brothers until I saw that documentary, which was a really boring documentary, by the way. But his voice, you know, so many people have emulated that. And the first one that comes to mind is David Bowie. And I don't think that Bowie holds a candle to Scott Walker, because there's a depth and resonance to, you know, I don't even want to start talking about this in a way that's going to, it's bound to sound kind of pretentious or like I'm thinking about it too much, but there's this kind of, you know, there's an old-fashioned kind of thing that he's doing, and it's kind of like, you know, this big upswell of, you know, I don't know what the word is, but it's like, you know, there's this aching kind of quality to what he does. But, you know, like I said, I think David Bowie does the same thing, you know, tries to sing like him, but doesn't really even come close. I never liked David Bowie's vocals at all, whereas I could listen to Scott Walker sing, even like with this song, where the song, just the production on the song makes it sound just ridiculous.
Yeah, you say it's dated. I'm actually surprised by that. I actually think the production is fantastic, and it's clean, it's interesting. I think it's way ahead of its time.
You think that disco stuff is ahead of its time?
Well, I don't
it was
know,
the 70s. I mean,
there's like a keyboard or a bass guitar doing something that is, I think, very ahead of its time, actually, in the verse. Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying it's light years ahead of its time, but it's a sound that I think people end up emulating, like you talk about his vocals. I think it's a really interesting song, actually. And it's funny, you know, I'm not sure why people are so enthralled by Scott Walker and the Walker Brothers. I mean, I also watched a documentary just a couple nights ago, and I found a lot of his music to be really, really, really cheesy. But, you know, you watch this documentary and you see all these, you know, famous musicians and producer types, from Brian Eno to, as a singer with big, thick glasses, whose name I can't remember right now. He's in some band. I'm sorry, I can't remember his name right now. You know, and even David Bowie and all these other guys, you know, kind of talk about the greatness of Scott Walker, and I think he's solid, you know, but I think Bowie's better myself. I actually think Bowie's voice is better and his style is better. I think his vocals resonate more, which just goes to show you that either I have no idea what I'm talking about, or there's again, it's just an example of, you know, you can't argue music because it's all about taste and preference.
Yeah, I guess I have a tendency, I'm not really sure where I picked it up, but I have a tendency when I sing to go into that kind of, like, do some of those little crooning things. And my producer is always putting the brakes on me and asking me to cut it out. I do it in the Riverdales because I essentially produce my own vocals in the Riverdales, and so I can kind of indulge myself a little bit more with that. But you know, there's something about that style in general that I like, and then the way he does it, again, I think it's a precursor to what David Bowie did. And as we were talking about the other day, I don't like David Bowie at all, and I never have. And I just think that this guy's voice, you know, the way he sings is a lot more interesting to me. You know, I think Bowie, you know, I always think of Bowie as doing, you know, his vocals are kind of robotic to me. Hmm. It's like it's almost like he's trying to strip out all human emotion from his vocal, and Scott Walker, I think, does the opposite. I think he's, you know, I mean, like you said earlier, that it comes off kind of cheesy, some of their stuff, or corny, but that's a large part of the reason why, is because it's all theatrical, but it's not theatrical in the way that, you know, a Broadway musical would be or something like that. In a weird way, it seems like it doesn't fit with the music, and yet you can't imagine it, you know, you can't really imagine the music being something other than it is. I mean, it's, you know, whatever else you want to say about the guy, I think you can't argue that he's not unique.
Well, yeah, I agree with you. There's no question he's unique. And, you know, it's kind of fun to, you know, oftentimes what people do when they're into music is they always wait for the next new thing. And I find the next new thing most of the time to be really dissatisfying. The next new thing is usually crappy, an imitation of something older. And so what I've been doing lately is kind of just delving back into the past and trying to discover new things. Like, you know, I've never really gotten deep into the Kinks, so I've been doing that. Scott Walker and the Walker Brothers, a few things there. Some Nick Drake. I'm not sure what else here, but, you know, just other... I'm trying to kind of go backwards as opposed to forwards because I'm figuring that it'll be easier to find good music if I do that, because there's so many people out there who have already kind of, you know, walked this path, so I can kind of follow their lead, if you will.
You know, if music were to just, you know, if people were to stop making new music today, I think it would just probably be decades before I could catch up,
yeah,
and investigate everything that I would like to investigate. From the past, I mean, it would probably take me a decade for the 60s alone. You know, it amazes me. I mean, I've never really been much of a big record buyer. When I was a teenager, I was, but really by the time I was doing a band actively, I didn't have money for music, and I just became less and less interested in listening to, you know, other music, and more, I guess, in writing my own. So I went through a long period of time where, you know, I just didn't buy a lot of music. And, you know, I've just never been one of those guys who kind of dives in and, you know, finds this obscure band or that, you know, guy or whatever. And, so, you know, the advantage to that is that I can come across a lot of that stuff at a point where I'm probably going to be more receptive to it and have maybe a little bit more of an attention span for it. In the same way that, you know, if I read a book like, you know, a Charles Dickens book or something, or Graham Greene, I'm going to get a lot more out of it now than I would have when I was a teenager. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have more patience, I have a different perspective, etc. But anyway, that's my very long roundabout way of saying that I don't have much in the way of a musical education in terms of, you know, being really well-versed in rock. I mean, you talk to somebody who's a real music fanatic, and, you know, they're going to be able to rattle off the names of these records and songs and stuff, and I can't. And, I don't know what my point was. I completely meandered off my point.
Sorry about that. You're just kind of backing up my point that maybe it's okay to look backwards as opposed to forward.
Oh, right. Exactly. Discover. So, yeah, I mean, I would have, I mean, I could spend just a ridiculous amount of time just catching up on, gosh, I'm tired, on what I haven't heard already. But having said that, there, you know, I actually bought a record earlier today on the recommendation of Dave Williams, the drummer for the Steve Adamek band.
Hmm.
And he recommended this band that they're buddies with from Montreal. And I bought the record, and now I really am tired. Now I can't remember the name of the band. Sonic Avenues. And I think the record came out last year. But it's, you know, it's in that same vein as the Steve Adamek band. And there's a great band from Sudbury, Ontario called Statues. It's very heavily influenced by power pop and also by 70s, you know, late 70s punk rock, especially British punk rock, really melodic stuff. And then it's all kind of recorded with the garage band mentality. They're kind of lo-fi, but really powerful recordings. And, you know, so much of that, you know, you were saying earlier that you find that these things that are going to be the next big thing or whatever, are just kind of doing what's already been done in the past. But really the definition of a great rock and roll band is a band that can take all these elements from the past and kind of mix them together and then infuse them with their own, you know, personality and character and take on the world and create something that's completely familiar but totally new at the same time. And that's really what I felt like when I was listening to this record today. I was like, wow, you know, the vocals are really, you know, it reminds me of one band that I can't even think of at the moment. And then it reminds me of the Barracudas as well, who were a British band, but the singer was Canadian and these guys are Canadian. You know, I'm making all these kind of connections. But also, you know, the record's kind of short and it's, you know, there's not a lot of songs on it and it goes by fast and you kind of just get caught up in it. But I think that's a large part of what makes a great rock and roll band is stuff they're taking from the past.
Yeah. And I would agree with you. What's the name of the band again?
I forgot again.
Something you said Suburban something or.
No, it's an S. Sonic Avenues. I'm telling you, man, I got to get to bed early tonight. I'm out of it.
What happened? You're up early snow blowing and it made you tired. And what's the deal? Come on.
I'm just, you know, there's a world of difference between 5:30 in the morning and 6:30 in the morning. It's only an hour, but it's a really important hour.
Yeah. Our dog has decided that at about 6 o'clock every morning, he's going to start whimpering and whining for here, we got to take a break for a second, Ben.
Yeah.
And my friend has just stopped by to pick up his kids. So just, let's take a 5-minute break.
Yep.
All right, switching gears here on Weasel Radio, Owen Murphy here in Shoreline, Washington, Ben Weasel in Madison, Wisconsin. Ben, in my hands right now, an article from Smithsonian.com, the headline, When Elvis Met Nixon, under the headline it writes, 40 years ago, an Oval Office photograph captured the bizarre encounter between the King of Rock and Roll and the President. You know, and the meaning itself isn't that interesting other than, you know, Elvis Presley is wearing what looks like a Hulk Hogan, you know, WrestleMania belt and his... in this bizarre outfit in the thick mutton chops sideburns, and he may very well be stoned. He kind of looks goofy. He's got these huge, huge collars and necklaces and stuff, and he's next to this straight-laced politician who's kind of a weirdo himself. So, you know, the meaning itself to me isn't that interesting, but what is interesting is the story behind the picture. And I'll read a little bit what Smithsonian.com has written here. And the writer's name is Peter Carlson, so credit him. He says, the picture is genuine, an official White House photograph of a bizarre encounter that occurred in this universe, in the Oval Office on December 21st, 1970. The story began in Memphis a few days earlier when Elvis's father, Vernon, and his wife, Priscilla, complained that he'd spend too much on Christmas presents, more than $100,000 for 32 handguns and 10 Mercedes-Benzes. Did you say Benzes or Benz?
Benzes, I guess.
Benzes, okay. Peeved, Elvis drove to the airport and caught the next available flight, which happened to be bound for Washington. He checked into a hotel, then got bored and decided to fly to Los Angeles. Elvis was traveling with some guns and his collection of police badges, and he decided that what he really wanted was a badge from the Federal Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs back in Washington. So he's in Los Angeles. Now he decides, well, I got to get back to Washington. And this is a quote from Priscilla Presley in her book, Elvis and Me. She writes, the NARC badge represented some kind of ultimate power to him. With the federal narcotics badge, Elvis believed he could legally enter any country both wearing guns and carrying any drugs he wished. And I don't really have much to add to this other than it's just hilarious, and I love this photo. And I am continually amazed by Elvis and his absolute bizarre behavior and this idea that he would want to have some kind of badge so that he could carry guns and drugs of any kind wherever he wanted, whenever he wanted. And that he even thought this could happen or would work is amazing to me.
You know, the thing that really stuck out to me about this story was I want to know, even in $1970, to get 10 Mercedes right. and 32 handguns for $100,000, that is a bargain, man. That is an unbelievable bargain, isn't it?
Well, yeah, and you toss in the Ginsu knife set right now, they'll also throw in the Ronco soda maker.
You know, the other thing is, I don't think it's hilarious. I think it's profoundly sad.
Oh, that's interesting.
And the man was, first of all, a drug addict, and second of all, I mean, I think it's safe to say was so famous, so and so rich, and so completely removed from what it's like to live a normal life, that he was just out of his mind. I mean, it's really bad. And but it's things that happen sometimes to wealthy people. They use their wealth to kind of continually chase, you know, their version of happiness, and they just make themselves more and more miserable. I mean, they're rich enough to really kind of have the world, so to speak, and yet their world gets smaller and smaller and smaller, and you end up, I mean, it's funny because it's, you know, it's the same is kind of true in some sense with drug users where you know, so there's these two elements coming where you get these insane ideas and you not only think they're normal, but you have surrounded yourself with other people who assure you that they're normal. So like if you're a drug user, you're around other drug users who think your insanity is completely rational, and then you pile on top of that, you're a rich guy and nobody wants to say no to you, and they're constantly propping up your ego. I mean, it's really a recipe for disaster. I mean, the story of Elvis Presley is ultimately a really sad one.
Yeah. Thanks.
I'm sorry to bring everything down. I know you think it's hilarious, but I don't.
Ben, I don't think
I never knew the story behind this meeting. Obviously, I knew about the meeting and I had seen the photo, but I'd never known about it. And it's just, I find it really sad.
I can understand your point of view saying his untimely death at the age of 43 on a toilet is sad. Sure, he dies young, but I'm sorry. I mean, there's something about a drug-addled rock star trying to get a badge from the Federal Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs, and then the government allowing him to do this, you know, and then him showing up in this ridiculous.
No. Allowing him to do what? They didn't give him the badge.
They gave him the badge.
I thought the story made it really clear that they didn't give it to him.
No, I read this earlier today. They gave him a badge.
I read that they didn't, that they turned him down.
So Nixon asked someone whose last name was spelled K-R-O-G-H, Krog, Crow, I don't know. Nixon says, can we get him a badge? And this guy says that he could. And Nixon ordered it done.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Elvis was ecstatic. In a surprising, spontaneous gesture, Elvis put his left arm around the president and hugged him. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I guess I didn't read the whole article, and now that I think of it, of course I knew that the whole meeting was purportedly about some sort of war on drugs, wasn't it, something like that?
Well, what Elvis tells him in a letter is that he will do everything he can to help him fight the war on drugs. You know, and Nixon is convinced that the drugs are fueling the counterculture that is a part of the the Vietnam protesters, the anti-Vietnam sentiment within the country. Because you couldn't possibly be stone sober and be against the Vietnam War. So in my search for, I thought we'd play an Elvis song, and of course the first song I always think of when I think of Elvis, because I'm not really a big Elvis fan, is In the Ghetto, and I found a version in which his daughter.
You pronounce that really interestingly. In the ghetto. Can you say that again?
In the ghetto. Did I say that interesting?
Well, I'm using me. You can do it again if you'd like.
I'm not sure why it's funny. I'm saying it the way Elvis sings it, in the ghetto. That's the way I'm saying it. So anyhow, so what's so funny? Do you want to explain what's funny to everyone else, Ben? Would you like to?
I don't think anybody else needs an explanation.
Ah, okay. Well then, at some point, please explain it to me, because I don't think I was being funny there, and I think you're being mean spirited.
Why do you throw that phrase around? I'm not being mean-spirited. You said ghetto. It sounds funny.
Hang on one second. Miss Olivia would like to say something here. My daughter, who's 6 years old, has a question for me. Olivia, go ahead. She's drawn a picture. Ben, I will show it to you right now. It's a hardy flower. We will take a picture of this.
Yeah. That's very nice.
Yeah. So we'll take a picture of this and put it up on the Weasel Radio page on Facebook.com. Can I hang on to this, honey? You want to say hi to everybody? Say something. Come on. God, every time. Anyhow, the girls won't talk in front of a microphone. You got to leave that.
You're their dad, not their producer. Let it go.
I'm all things. So I wanted to play the song for you that, you know how Natalie Cole sang the duets with her father, Nat King Cole, just adding her vocals over his tracks and stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's just ghoulish to call that a duet.
Well, I don't know.
That's not a duet.
I don't know what it is. I mean, I'm just trying to describe
it. A duet implies consent. We're going to do this thing together.
So when
one of the people is dead,
there's
no consent.
So your feeling here is that Nat King Cole never would have allowed this to happen. If
No, I have no idea whether he would have. That's my feeling. I'm not saying it's wrong to do it. I just...
Well, anyhow,
I find it odd.
Well, and I suppose there's something, I agree with you, but there's, whatever, it doesn't matter. I don't really have a strong opinion one way or the other, I find the version I'm going to play for you here of In the Ghetto, with Elvis Presley and Lisa Marie Presley to be somewhat humorous. Maybe you'll turn this into something sad too. So may I play this for you right now?
Yeah, you don't need my permission.
Why don't you shut up?
As the snow flies on a cold and gray Chicago morning, a poor little baby child is born in the ghetto, and his mama cries.
'Cause if there's one thing that she don't need, it's another hungry mouth to feed in the ghetto.
The ghetto.
People, don't you understand? The child needs a helping hand. He's gonna be an angry old man someday. Take a look at you and me. Are we too blind to see? Do we simply turn our heads and look the other way? Well, the world turns.
A hungry little boy with a red nose plays in the street as the cold wind blows in the ghetto.
All right, Ben, here's my question for you. Do you love this or do you love this?
I don't know. Does she have a... is she a singer? Is that her profession?
I mean, she's released music.
What does she do for a living?
She's rich. Because her dad was famous.
That's her job?
I don't know. It's really.
Does she have a career in anything?
I don't think so.
No, I mean, I'm just wondering because I didn't know she had released any music. I never knew she was supposedly a singer.
I mean, I think her job has been either being born by a famous singer or having a fake marriage to another famous singer, Michael Jackson. Otherwise, I don't think she really ever had any type of career other than living off of the royalties of her father's music. Which, I'll tell you what, if I could, I, you know, if there is some college I can go to learn how to get that gig, I'm in. That sounds pretty fun to me.
Let me ask you something completely off subject, and we haven't planned on talking about this today, and if you haven't heard of it, we won't. Are you familiar with the Bed Intruder video?
Is that the video where they... let me just turn this down a little bit here. Is that the video where they take a news clip and use that vocoder thing of a guy who's kind of got a sassy way of talking, and we're going to find you
yeah.
and stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's I think it's kind of interesting, actually. What's your thoughts?
I want to know your thoughts. That's why I asked.
Well, why do I have to start? Why do I have to start off? Why can't you start?
Because I brought the subject up specifically to get your opinion. I'm trying to.
All right.
Would you just answer the question? What the hell? What do you think of it? What do you think of somebody having done that? And what do you find it hilarious?
Oh, I didn't think it was funny. I thought it was really interesting. I mean, you know, I think it's interesting when someone finds a new way to make music out of something. But I don't think the song's very good. And I think the guy who's they've taken his speech or rant to the news folks in whatever town he's in, I think he's really compelling, and I think his speech patterns are musical, actually. You know, and he's got this kind of bravado that I think is fascinating. So those things I like, but the song itself I don't think is that great. Does that answer your question? I guess.
I mean, there's sort of, you know, some other stuff around that where, you know, like the video was done, but then, like, the video that I saw on YouTube, it was followed by, like, some, you know, just really typical late 20s, early 30s, white, urban, you know, probably comes from the suburbs, nerdy guy, you know, sitting down and you know, playing it on the piano and singing it all faux earnestly. And
God.
And that was linked from a thing at Liberty University, which was the university that Jerry Falwell founded, where this woman who you know, comes out with like a faux hawk, as we used to call it, a mohawk but with hair on the sides of the head, and conducts a chorus of evangelical Christian students in singing it. And I was just completely appalled. I mean, I was completely appalled because, I mean, essentially what you're doing is you're let's laugh at poor people. Aren't they silly? Aren't these people who live in the ghetto and talk this way, aren't they comical? Aren't they amusing?
Oh, is that how you...
I found it really, 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 I guess, offensive. I guess I was offended.
So you're saying that the song that was created off this guy's rant on a news station was offensive? Because you think the people are laughing at him?
I'm not necessarily saying that the thing they initially did with it was, I probably feel the same way you do about it. I don't really have much of an opinion on it. I mean, I had never heard of it before until this morning, but I'm saying the surrounding stuff that I saw, like the guy sitting down at the piano and he's going to pretend to be, you know, all serious about it. And because that's comedy, like laughing at poor people is comedy. And it's funny to me that happened, because usually people will laugh at poor ones. You know, they're the ones who are kind of the last segment in society that it's okay to be prejudiced against, really, and to laugh at and to be the butt of everybody's joke. They're stupid and they're hicks and blah, blah, blah. This guy in the video was black, and more than that, he was, you know, rather obviously gay. Apparently he later acknowledged that he is gay.
Oh, he's gay. So, I didn't know that. Okay. Interesting.
Yeah. So in one fell swoop, you're making fun of a poor black guy from the ghetto who's also gay. And apparently that's supposed to be entertainment. And I just, again, I mean, I hate to bring the, I realize we're supposed to be entertaining people with this show, but I just don't.
Yeah, Yeah, you're
maybe you're just in a mood today. I don't know, but I just don't find it funny, man.
What? I mean, come here. Give me. Let's okay. Bring it in for the real thing. Let's have a hug here for a second. You need a hug. Come here. Come here. Come on.
Honestly, does it not bother you when urban hipsters make fun of people they believe to be kind of culturally inferior? Because there's something about that that really chaps my ass, I guess. Gives me the red ass.
Well, I don't ever notice. Well, I'm not around hipsters ever. So.
You live in Seattle, for crying out loud. You're surrounded by, you're drowning in that.
Yeah, well, that's your perceived notion of what Seattle is. Seattle is so much like Madison. Okay. I mean, everyone essentially wears Patagonia, just like in Madison, man. It's just as
dumb. Yes, exactly. Madison is the same way, precisely. Just made my point for
me. Madison's not remotely full of any hipsters. There's not even a hipster there. You might be the hippest person in Madison. There's not one hip person in Madison. I'm sorry.
All right. Yeah. Well, we've gotten completely off the subject, and now we're arguing about something that's completely and totally irrelevant to the conversation.
Oh, I'm sorry. Forgive me. This is what I do sometimes, so I apologize.
I do it.
Yeah, you know, it's. I guess it's too bad that people are making fun of this guy. I mean, I think actually I think he has kind of talent, as a matter of fact. You know, I found him engaging to watch, as a matter of fact. And I thought his performance was, if it wasn't, I guess performance isn't the right word. It's such a weird video. You know, there's another guy who takes.
Well, but Owen, that's the point. That's part of the point is that, you know, I think is that it is a performance because, I mean, that's the way our culture is now. If somebody puts a camera in front of you, you put on a show because that's like half of what's on TV is stuff that, you know, is supposedly real. And of course, I mean, in reality, it's, you know, it's not any more real than like a sitcom or anything. But I think that was part of the point of the thing that was going on was like the guy was, you know, when they were originally doing this thing, the guy was obviously putting on a performance. But like I said, I mean, the point that I was getting at was that I think there's this, you know, back in 2004, this term was coined, I don't remember who did it, Jesus land, to describe basically the majority of the country, you know, and the idea was that basically most of us are hicks and imbeciles, and that's why, you know, we didn't do the smart thing and elect John Kerry to the presidency, which in retrospect sounds so absurd. It's hard to believe there was even a contest, but there's this, I know it because I've been so involved in it and been so close to it for so many years and was that way myself when I was younger. There's a real hostility among certain people, you know, kind of the people who I think fancy themselves to be the cultural elite, fancy themselves to be the smart people. There's a real hostility and arrogance and condescension towards regular people. And I think that's what they see. I mean, I think that's why these people are making fun of stuff like this. It's like, you know, it doesn't even occur to them to stop and think that that there might be something wrong with that. I mean, the whole reason why the guy was talking to the camera was because his sister was almost raped by a guy who came in the bedroom window. I mean, is it really that funny a situation?
That's a rhetorical question that I don't have to answer. No, clearly it's not funny. Clearly not funny. This is awkward.
I mean, I've said everything I had to say. I guess you don't have anything to say.
Well, I made my point earlier, and I stand by it. You know, it's.
I don't think you discussed really almost at all the stuff that I've been talking about. I mean, you talked about the video itself, but I don't think you've offered an opinion unless I am forgetting, which I probably.
There's one thing I want to add, and if you want to, I can share my opinion on hipsters attacking those who are poor. there's a there's a and I know that's a poor encapsulation of what you said.
I love the way you reduce my passionate, well thought out. I'm agonizing over these things as I you know, work them out in my head as I'm speaking, and you reduce them to just it's as though I walked in, you know, I'm a boy who walked into his parents' dinner party carrying a wagon with his own turd in it.
I always tell you the same thing when we're done with a show or whatever, that I think you actually are a really compelling guy who has really fascinating point of view on numerous different topics. You think I'm being sarcastic here, and I'm not. And I don't know that I'm that person. So, you know, when I start kind of delving into these topics, you know, I don't know that I had
a lot. But you're a guy who thinks on his feet.
Yeah.
And that's why I think it's okay. You know, like we did that stream of consciousness thing last week. I mean, I think it's okay for us to do that because you're quick-witted enough to kind of think on your feet.
And okay.
I'll
give you an opinion.
Maybe you're not, but what I'm doing on the show every day, I don't prepare at all. Like, you send me topic ideas, and I kind of really give them a very brief once-over. I don't go into depth reading the stuff or watching the video or anything. Basically, I am thinking out loud on this show. I'm kind of coming to conclusions and developing opinions as I speak.
Yeah,
I mean, and I think you're good at that too. So,
so here's what I would say. I think I haven't seen the videos you're describing here other than the first one. Okay.
Well, then maybe we should just take. Maybe you should, and we should just take up the conversation again tomorrow.
Well,
but with that said,
what I would say is that I don't know. I guess the hipster kind of making fun of the guy. If that's what he's doing, I guess that's offensive. I don't know. I mean, it feels to me, and I don't think Liberty University is making fun of the guy. Maybe I suppose they are. I guess I don't know. But I think it's deeper than that. It's more. There's more to it. I think that this guy is truly a compelling character, and is musical in just his delivery, and that in itself is interesting, and people are interested and attracted to it. And want to kind of glom onto it. So while they might in one sense be making fun of him, I think they're also kind of appreciating him. I mean, that's my reaction to what you're saying.
I think that's true, but it reminds me of. I think you're absolutely right. It disturbs me. I sense
condescension.
Real hostility and condescension. I mean, a good example is there's a guy who's dead now who. Named Wesley Willis in Chicago.
Oh, I met Wesley Willis.
Yeah, he was a black guy. He was schizophrenic.
Yeah,
and you know, just not in a good situation in life.
And he made music, right? Didn't he like?
And he made very, very bad music that nobody in their right mind would ever listen to and go, "This is good." But people went, "This is good," because it was kitschy and funny that a crazy black schizophrenic guy was writing, you know, songs about punk rock bands that weren't songs. They were just like gibberish. I mean, it was total, utter crap. But there was a certain type of person that was just like, oh, he's so brilliant. He's so great. And it really, really got under my skin. I mean, I met the guy a couple times because he apparently would make the rounds to these various studios where he would work. He owed them all money. But he would make the rounds. Like, he came to one once. I think he was trying to get some free studio time or something. But there were a couple times when I was making records where he would show up. And, I mean, the guy was in bad shape. And, I mean, obviously he died, you know, relatively young. But, I mean, he had scar tissue all over his forehead from smashing his head into walls and stuff. And I remember when we were recording at a studio that's no longer open called Acme. And I was having a conversation with the engineer, and I guess there was an assistant engineer as well. A couple of actually really intelligent, I think, thoughtful guys. And we were discussing that. Like, is it appropriate, you know, to derive amusement or entertainment value from a situation like that? And one of them was arguing, well, you know, he's making money that he wouldn't be making otherwise. But my argument was, well, you know, so is a prostitute, so is a drug dealer. I mean, that doesn't mean that that doesn't make it okay. That doesn't mean that people who buy drugs from the drug dealer are like doing him a favor or helping him in life, or that the people who patronize prostitutes or strippers or what have you are helping those women out. So And like I said, it just always it kind of made my skin crawl when I would hear people talk about this guy's alleged genius. Because again, I mean, I think if you took away the guy's circumstances in life and presented that music on its own, I find it impossible to believe that those same people have the slightest interest in it. I mean, I think the interest in it was that the guy was severely mentally ill.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I thought his music was awful, clearly, and didn't think it was funny, and thought it was kind of a waste of time, actually. And who was – there was a guy out of Austin, Texas, who also suffered
from – Yeah, Daniel Johnston. I mean, similar. He obviously had more talent, but it's a similar thing where people tell me how genius this guy is, and I'm like, seriously, are you kidding me? This is utter and complete crap. Guy is just terrible.
Yeah, it's just crazy people making crazy music. I mean, you know, and sometimes – you know, those who are insane make interesting art. You know, it wasn't Van Gogh known to be fairly nuts? And I'm sure music history.
I'm not really sure. I think later in life, but if you read some of, you know, you read some of his letters and stuff, he actually sounds like he's kind of got his head screwed on right.
Well, okay. Well, you know, I don't know, but
you know, I think later in his life he became mentally ill and, you know, was cutting his own ear off and stuff like that.
Which, you know, who
I don't
us,
think that's the sign of a healthy mind.
Yeah. Well, you know, I
but hey, I'm no psychologist, so you know.
Hey, do you mind if I shift gears for a second here, Mister?
I don't mind. Shift the gear.
So yesterday I played a song of yours from the latest Riverdales album. Do I say is it the Riverdales or Riverdales?
I really don't care.
Okay, fine.
I say the Riverdales.
From the latest the Riverdales album. That feels weird to say. And the song was Gemini Man. Very good song. I like it very much. All of us who
that was the 2 records ago.
Oh, that was 2. Oh, shoot.
Yeah.
Well, the release date was the latest. Whatever. Anyhow.
No, the latest release date is 2010. We haven't come out like I don't know 6-8 months ago.
I don't want to talk about it anymore.
And then we had one come out last year, and that's from the one that came out last year.
Okay, so I played the song on our show yesterday. You didn't know that. I kind of edited it into the show afterwards because it fit with what you were talking about. That'd be fun, just kind of, you know, shake things up, put a song in there. So I went to iTunes and I downloaded the song, and it cost 99 cents. I was happy to pay for it. So, and I know you get half of that in the royalties, which is good. And so
I get half of it. Wow, that's news to me. I'm very happy knowing that.
Well, I'll send you 2 quarters. How about that? After I downloaded iTunes, recommended another musician that I would like based on downloading Gemini Man by the Riverdales. Can you guess? I bet you I could give you 100 guesses. I could give you 100 guesses, and you would never come anywhere near who they recommended. Nowhere near.
It's funny. I mean, all the iTunes, Amazon, I mean, whatever algorithm or whatever it is they're using to determine this stuff is so far off the mark. You know, Twitter has their who you should follow, and it's just a rogues gallery of people I want nothing to do with. That if I could somehow make it that they never popped up again, I would, you know, I'd wave the magic wand and do it. So, no, I probably couldn't guess, but it's probably not going to shock me. I mean, if you said Barbara Streisand, I'd be like, I'm not surprised.
I think this will shock you. Here's what I'm going to play. I'm going to play the song for you. And I don't even think you're going to know who it is until, you know, a minute into the song, actually. And I'm not even sure then if you'll
know. I probably won't ever know who it is, actually.
Well, it's a famous singer, but...
Okay, just tell me this. You didn't pay for this, did you?
This song I went to YouTube and got and just recorded into my computer, which I suppose is illegal. So don't tell anyone that I did that. Do you know this band? The singer? Here, I'll turn it up.
No.
Yeah.
It's a new country thing, isn't it?
No.
Is it Kid Rock?
No. It sounds like... No, this song is like 20, 25 years old.
Isn't this kind of stuff Kid Rock is doing now?
Yes.
Like bad 70s rock?
Yeah, this is a great song. Well, I'm kidding, but...
The voice man sounds on the Mexican crazy. Border. Is it ZZ Top? The voice sounds familiar. Really bad singer. Is it Joe Walsh?
No.
It could be any though. It could. It probably couldn't be ZZ Top, but it could be Joe Walsh, couldn't it?
This sounds like, yeah, sure. It's Eddie Money, of course. You know, I mean, when you think of, you think of all kind of pop punk fans, and their record collections. You got the Ramones.
His voice was never good in the first place, but it's just shot. I mean, it's completely shot.
No, that's just his style, man. It's just the bluesy growl of the one, the only, appearing.
Oh, and his voice is shot.
No,
I can't believe he released this.
This is Eddie Money, man.
I mean, it's just not even close.
By the way, he's coming to a casino near you.
Yeah, that's really me.
It's the truth. He is. I think he was just here, actually, in Seattle.
I don't think it's funny to make fun of the guy. That's all.
What is wrong with you today?
I'm pulling the leg. I think it's hilarious to make fun of the guy. No, actually, I don't think it's hilarious to make fun of him either. I really couldn't care either way. I mean, Eddie Money, he had one hit.
No, he had lots of hits. But what I understand is why would you buy a Riverdale song and then they say, well, you know what you'd like. Eddie Money. I was like, what the hell?
He probably has a song. You bought a song called Gemini Man. He probably has a song that has Gemini in the title.
Maybe he is a Gemini.
And that's how their half-assed algorithm works.
All right, so our fake producer, Applesauce McGee, and I think he should be our producer, actually. Without actually being involved, when we talk about our producer, we'll say Applesauce McGee.
So an executive producer.
Sure, okay, he's our executive producer, absolutely.
That's too bad, because I was actually, and I'm not kidding at all, I hate to interrupt you, but I actually had determined this morning, and now I can't do it, to list him as executive producer on the new Screeching Weasel album, but now I can't.
Why can't you? No one listened to this.
Because you, I mean, I can't prove that I came up with that idea first.
I think we'll believe you, Ben. What are you worried?
It's not worth ending up in court over with you. I mean, take it, man. It's yours.
Okay.
It's not important enough.
Well, then you got to find something else for him to do on the record, brother. You know, this is important. Applesauce McGee, you got to get him in the fold.
But no, I don't.
He wanted to remind me that you had asked him to remind me to talk about the death tolls in Afghanistan, and my response was, "Oh, really?" So I don't know if you.
Yeah, that war stuff was so interesting to talk about when Bush was in office, but now that Obama's in office, can we just not talk about the war and how the death toll is like skyrocketed and it's just like a ridiculous. It's like, what is it, 5 times or something even higher than that than it ever was in Iraq. But no, you know, we've moved on. Let's just not talk about that. We were really concerned about dead soldiers and innocent civilians being killed when it was in Iraq. But you know, it's not of the moment. We don't need to discuss that.
Yeah, I agree with everything you just said right there. No, I'm kidding. I guess, you know, I mean, I don't know. It's just. I don't know. Just one of those things that's just a total bummer. I mean,
the only excuse I've heard for this, for why people aren't up in arms about this, was so strange to me that I kind of couldn't believe it. And the argument was, well, people were always in favor of the war in Afghanistan. That's where they said we should be. And assuming that that's totally true, which I don't think that was ever true for the anti-war protesters, but let's grant that point for a second. So that means any kind of death toll is acceptable? We approve of this, so however many people die, that's fine. No problem.
Okay, are we supposed to buy that?
Well,
take me through this. Do you have a problem with how the administration is handling the war in Afghanistan? And are you surprised?
I don't have a problem with how the administration is handling the war in Afghanistan, because I'm really not aware of it, because it's not in the news. It's just not worthy to. It's not worth discussion anymore. War is not worth discussion. Obama, you know, and it's the unfortunate thing that I've noticed with Democrats and with liberals in general is that they will scream and clench their fists and stamp their feet when there's a Republican in office and there's a war going on. But a Democrat can do pretty much whatever the hell he wants, not even so much, I think, because these people believe it's politically justified, but because they're lazy. Oh, the Democrat's in office, fine. We don't have to think anymore. We don't have to worry about anything anymore.
Yeah,
it's fine.
I mean, the thing is, actually, you know, I'm actually fascinated by the war in Afghanistan, and I've read a number of books recently about it. And, you know, the conclusion I've come to is that it is absolutely categorically unwinnable unless you throw in 500,000 to a million troops. And then I still don't think it's winnable, because in the end, what the war is, isn't a war of, in the classic sense of, you know, giant brigades going up against each other, or even a, you know, it's more difficult than even a guerrilla war. These are, you know, there's a few disparate souls as part of Al-Qaeda and portions of the Taliban hiding in caves, you know, building little bombs and scaring the crap out of the military there, to the point where they can't move without feeling like they're going to be, have their legs blown off. You know, they're paralyzed. And you can't defeat an army that, or an enemy that constantly disappears into caves and fights this way. It's almost unwinnable. So, I mean, I'm actually,
if only we'd had something in at least recent history to look to guide us, to help us figure out if perhaps it might not be a good idea to try to fight a ground war in Afghanistan. If only. But we don't, so, you know. Uh-oh.
You know, I'm kind of confused as to where you're coming from here. Are you pointing a finger at this current administration? Are you pointing a finger at the government the last 12 years?
I'm actually not pointing finger at anybody. I mean, if I'm pointing finger at anybody, it's, you know, to the extent that we can damage and maybe someday ultimately remove the Taliban and or any other group of people who think that way, you know, I'm all for it. I mean, I think that the war against terrorism is a war of ideology, very similar to the Cold War. You know, that was a war of ideology, and this is as well, and I do think that we will ultimately prevail. I think that whatever our flaws as a nation, whatever our mistakes in foreign policy over the years, ultimately we stand for what is good, and the people who want to stone and kill and torture and maim homosexuals, women who literally talk out of turn. You know, I was reading and unfortunately saw the photograph in National Geographic of a woman who had in Afghanistan, actually, who had fled her abusive husband. He caught her, and him and a couple of his buddies took her up into the hills and cut off her nose and her ears.
Oh, I just saw that. Yep.
Yeah. So. I have, you know, to me, I don't understand how you could possibly hesitate to call that mindset evil, and how you could engage in any kind of cultural relativism to suggest that, you know, us bombing Dresden is you like that was wrong and therefore it's somehow on par with that, you know, or you know, hanging or stoning people for being homosexuals or any kind. So I think, you know, I think we've got to battle that ideology, and to that extent, okay, you know, I'm for it. But the reason that was given quite often, certainly back in 2004 and not so much these days, but we've got to find bin Laden. And I always thought that was stupid, and I admired the Bush administration for not really taking that tactic, not sort of throwing all their eggs into that basket, because this isn't, you know, we're not talking about like Hitler or Stalin. If you chop off the head of the snake is just going to grow another head. Okay. Because we're talking about an ideology. We're not talking about, a charismatic leader who somehow created all this. We're talking about a way of life and a way of thinking. So if bin Laden is captured or killed, I don't think it's going to stop Al-Qaeda. I don't think it's going to even cripple them. In fact, I don't think it's even going to slow them down. So from that perspective, I think it's an enormous waste.
I guess
the comments that I was making, I'm sorry, what's that?
Well, I just want to add something to that, because you know, to me, it's unfortunate. From what I've read, you know, and the, forgive me, someone who was part of the CIA and part of the administration during the Bush administration, you know, wrote a book that came out in 2008, and I can't remember the guy's name right now, so forgive me, and I just read it. And he talks about how, you know, he's really unhappy with how the Bush administration fought this war against terror, because he felt like, and many in the administration felt like, they had Bin Laden cornered in Pakistan, and they had the Pakistani army, the IPI, is that what they're called? You know, breathing down Bin Laden's throat, and they had their special rangers there as well, and they were slowly strangling him and about to capture him. And then the administration goes off on this battle to liberate Iraq, or however you want to put it, and I think loses a real opportunity. I don't agree. I think Bin Laden is actually in the world of jihadists, Al Qaeda, Islamic, you know, ultra fundamentalists. He is a charismatic figure, and he's more than just the head of a snake. And I do think if you got him, it would matter. That's just my opinion, and I don't want to belabor that, because I think
he's a hero. I'm not doubting that.
I don't want to go back and forth on that point, but I do think it was important to get him. I think we missed a real opportunity there, and it's really unfortunate.
I don't want to go back and forth on that point, because I like I said, he's a hero, but he's not. You know, when Hitler died, Nazism died. You know, that was the end of that. I mean, I'm not saying there still aren't people who adhere to that ideology, but it's not the force it was, and it never will be again. Okay, and I think that when Castro dies, you know, maybe both Castros, I don't think that communism is going to be the force in Cuba, most likely, that it's been.
So to follow your logic, then, if Bin Laden dies, then Al Qaeda won't be the force it's been.
No, that's the point. Is that I think this is a different situation. I think it's more akin to, you know, Joseph Stalin dies, but communism keeps going. I mean, because it's a deeper. The ideology speaks to something much deeper than, you know, Nazism did, or than Castro's version of communism does. I mean, and essentially, you know, the thing you've got to remember too is that I don't think in some of the, you know, in North Korea, for instance, you could argue that, you know, there are quite a lot of brainwashed people behind the scenes. But if you know, Kim Jong-il were deposed, I don't think that you'd find a bunch of people saying, but we had such a wonderful life here in North Korea. You know, I mean, these are oppressed people. When you're talking about the jihadists, you're talking about people. It's very interesting. The people who were the majority of the people who were implicated in the 9/11 attacks were college educated, came from middle class or wealthy families.
Yeah.
I mean, these weren't. It doesn't fit the narrative. That we're led to believe, including, I think, by people like Bin Laden. I mean, Bin Laden has quoted Noam Chomsky in his speeches. I mean, I think he's very good at playing, you know, guilty liberal Westerners. But the fact of the matter is, this isn't an ideology that's being driven by poverty, okay, that's being driven by even American presence on their soil. It's being driven by their religion, their view of their religion. And their view of their religion is you need to do one of two things, convert or die at our hands.
Well, no, I talked about this book. I'm sorry. I wish I had the guy's name. You know, the CIA operative that was high up in the administration wrote this book. And what he said was that what fueled Al-Qaeda was not just simply their religion, but their view of, you know, Jews of Israel, and how they felt that Israel was. And I'm going to paraphrase here. I'm going to get it kind of wrong and stuff. I want to say this correctly. I guess that, you know, that it's a whole Holy Land conversation again, which is, you know, for someone who's not remotely religious, this kind of stuff just makes me shake my head sometimes. But you know, they feel like, essentially, for lack of a better term, they're having their toes stepped on by the Jews in Israel, and they want them out, and nothing will do until they're gone, which of course isn't going to happen. And so you've got this perpetual problem that's never going to end. So you just have to, you know, from an outsider's point of view, from a Westerner's point of view, you have to manage it and, you know, at times kill these insane jihadists, you know.
Well, I think there were also, you know, I think the cultural aspects of sort of, you know, these countries that are thought of as being, you know, that aren't thought of as being, but that are primarily Muslim countries, are kind of intertwined with the religion, but not completely of the religion. You know, I think there are a lot of factors there, and there are probably quite a lot of things that you and I don't understand, and that, you know, maybe the vast majority of Westerners don't understand about why it is the way it is. But I also think we don't need to understand everything about it, because if somebody is cutting off a woman's nose because she tried to escape him because he was an abusive husband, and really, here in America, if somebody's cutting off a woman's nose for any reason, why we put him in jail? And that's a wonderful way to deal with it. And over there, it's business as usual. And I don't think that we need to really understand everything about the cultural milieu in order to say that is evil and we must combat that. Not only because it's evil, but because the ideology that kind of brews behind all this represents a real threat. And as I've said before, I mean, I think the reticence of this administration, Obama in particular, to identify that ideology as evil and to identify that ideology as the enemy, not Muslims. He's gone to great pains to say we're not at war with Muslims. Well, so did George Bush. We know that. Any thinking person knows that we're not at war with Islam, but that we are at war with this ideology. Okay, and if that offends some Muslims, too bad. You ought to be offended, because how can you defend things like that? You know, and if you can defend them, fine. Let's have that argument then. You know, if you can defend killing homosexuals for being homosexual, great. Well, I'd be happy to have that debate.
This conversation started with you kind of frustrated by the lack of, public and media scrutiny over the death tolls of our soldiers in Afghanistan.
And I don't know. I don't know if that's the right word. I mean, I think I am sort of almost objectively amused by the thing, because it's certainly not surprising to me.
You know, I guess to me it's somewhat sad, actually. You know, because the case I made before, I think this war is unwinnable. You know, it's funny. My mom had she said something really smart. She said, "How do you ever win a war?" Now, you know, I understand that's somewhat ridiculous. Sometimes, you know, if you look at World War II, for God's sakes, we had to win that war. You know, that was truly good against evil. You know,
but you know, that was the last war we were ever going to be in that was like that. Those kind of leaders like Hitler can't really exist in this world anymore. And the reason is because we now have bombs that can wipe out, you know, and that's how World War II ended, really. I mean, we dropped a big, powerful bomb. So that whole thing's in the past, and we're facing, you know, we faced the Cold War. We faced Vietnam. You know, we went in there and lost, you know, and we discovered that we're in a different world now than we were in World War I, World War II, and all the wars that came before that.
Well, so what do you,
the weaponry
well, so,
is advanced
hang on,
enough
hang on.
that we can't look at that anymore, and it probably is harder to define victory.
Well, so what do you want to say about the death toll in Afghanistan right now? Is there something you want to say
that
about
that people are dying at an unbelievable rate that far exceeds anything that ever happened in Iraq?
Yeah, I mean,
and I don't have the article in front of me, so I can't say what that rate is, which is why I asked McGee to talk to you about it, because I figured you, being the competent and reliable one, would probably have the information at hand, but you don't.
So let me get this straight. You asked our executive producer to tell me that you want to talk about something, but you didn't have the executive producer.
No.
A, you should have just told me. B, you should have had the executive producer at least get me the information so that I could help you build this conversation.
You're angry at both of you. And you haven't, you're doing it on a false premise.
I don't know what
I did not. I did not ask him. He said to me, in an email a while back, and I was catching up on my email this morning. He said to me, you should talk about that on Weasel Radio. And I said, oh, remind me. He said, well, I just did remind you. That's what that email was. And I said, well, remind Owen then. I mean, I was busy. You know, I didn't have time to go find the article again and print it out and whatever I had to do. So he went and reminded you.
You know, I don't know that I can work this way. You know what? I may have to fire our executive producer.
Wait, I mean, he hasn't even gotten his feet wet yet.
I may fire
You're a hard taskmaster, Owen Murphy.
So in the end, I'm trying to wrap my... So I guess what I would say is, you know, there was massive troop increases and, you know, as opposed to just laying back, which is what the military in Afghanistan has done for a number of years, they're actually taking the battle to Al-Qaeda and to the Taliban right now. So with that in mind, of course there's going to be more casualties. This administration...
Yeah, I know. That's how war works.
I know.
I'm well aware of that.
I'm still confused.
I just find the irony to be delicious. That's all.
What
yum.
What irony is delicious?
That anything that happened in Iraq was unduly scrutinized and criticized, and everything that happens in Afghanistan is summarily ignored.
Well, let me ask you this. Look, first off...
I don't know if I used that word right, but man, it made me feel smart.
Well, it sounded good, and it convinced me that you are smart. But I don't think... I'll make a statement first, then I'll ask you a question.
Are we just going to do like a three-hour show today? Because we've got to be going on like an hour and a half. I hope you're going to edit this in the two shows.
Wow. I didn't realize that. So... Clearly, I lost my train of thought there. But don't you see differences in the Iraq war and the war in Afghanistan? I do.
Certainly, I do.
Yeah, and I guess what I would say is that you started off this conversation by talking about how most people were for the war in Afghanistan, which is actually a war on terror, and most people are for that. And I don't care about the fringe left. Okay, I don't want to talk about them. They don't exist as far as I'm concerned. So what you have
that's really unfair to take that out of the fringe left were a huge part of the media coverage.
All right,
in the Iraq war. Right, so to say, I don't want to talk about them. Kind of
bring them back
in. That kind
bring,
of
bring them back in.
Cuts
bring,
my feet off.
Okay, I didn't mean to do that. Bring it. Come on. Yeah, come here. Long hair. Come here. Okay, you smell like patchouli, but come on in. Oh, you got a mohawk now. That's fantastic. Way to go. All right, so they're back in now. Okay, and they smell like patchouli. A lot of them are wearing masks because they're going to a protest. There's a lot of A's, anarchy A's on their shirts. They've spray painted because they want anarchists, and they're dangerous, and don't videotape them at a protest because then the CIA will get your videotapes and blah, blah, blah. I'm sorry. I just can't stand these people. And I've dealt with them in the past. So you've got, in comparison, you've got the war in Afghanistan, which is, in some sense, being fought or the idea behind it is honest, whereas the war in Iraq is one gigantic, ridiculous, rolling embarrassment of a lie.
Okay, well, right there, you might as well stop and forget it. I mean, I can't argue with that sort of absurd crap.
It's not crap, but it's not absurd. You know, the thing
yes, it is.
And it's not.
Because you're not saying, here, I think this is a good war and I think this is a bad war. What you're saying is there was some nefarious plot and it was dishonest and blah, blah, blah. And it's like, you know, grow up. No, it wasn't.
See,
and to characterize it that way puts you, I'm sorry to say, in the camp with these people who you dismissively refer to as, you know, the far left, long hair patchouli people, that you've just become that person. I mean, come on, stop embarrassing yourself, really,
well,
Owen. I got to be honest with you, it's getting under my skin a little bit.
Well, don't let that happen. I mean, I'm sharing my point of view. You want my opinion? I'm sharing it with you.
But we can't have an intelligent discussion anymore.
See,
if you take
you're being condescending.
No, I am not being condescending. I am saying you are bringing an emotionally charged element to this. You are making a claim that you cannot possibly substantiate. And you're stating it as fact. And that's what is getting under my skin. If you don't like the war in Iraq and you thought it was a bad idea, fine. Yeah. Make that point.
Okay.
Don't make the point that you're a mind reader, okay, and that you can divine the truth and falsehoods and it was dishonest and blah, 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 blah. Don't take that tack because frankly, it's beneath you.
Well, but here's the thing. Here's what I would say to that. I feel like I'm really fascinated by what's happening in the Middle East. And so I've done my share of reading for the last 5 years or so on this. And I've, you know, tried to study it so I could actually have what I think is an intelligent point of view on this. And from everything I've read, this is what I've come up with, that the administration drummed up, you know, a bunch of BS because you had neocons within the administration and informing the administration that felt it was important to get a foothold in the Middle East. You know, so they kind of.
Oh, and if we're gonna rehash this, this is a whole nother show.
Why
where
no?
We get to talk about, where we get to go back and let's look at the quotes from all the people who weren't part of the administration, who were in fact in every other way opposed to the administration, who said, "Yep, we agree with you. Yep, there are WMD in there," over and over and over. Because frankly, you're not going to come out of it looking like you know what you're talking about.
I think I'll do just fine, actually.
You know, hindsight is 20/20, and to look back and say, you know, to look, and here's what I don't understand about this. If you don't like the administration, you don't like the war, why not just look back and say, these idiots got it wrong? They got it wrong. But you've got to impute this thing onto them whereby you determined that it was all ginned up and it was this big lie, and there's nothing literally to support that. I mean, if you're gonna make the argument, I guess what I'm getting is, if you're gonna make that argument, fine, I will argue with you in good faith on that. But don't think for a second that you can just throw comments like that out there unchallenged. You're not going to, when if you're gonna argue with me, I'm not gonna sit here and say, oh yeah, as an article of faith, that war was completely phony and ginned up. No, it wasn't. And until you can prove it, then, you know, you're going to get an argument from me.
Well, I welcome the argument. And what I would say is that I probably can't.
Yeah, I think you're trying to turn your opinion into fact, I guess, is what I'm saying.
I don't know. Maybe. I mean, yeah, sure. Maybe that is what I'm doing. I mean, you know, but yeah, sure. Okay. It's my opinion, you know, based on a decent amount of study, you know, and maybe I'm wrong. You know, I'm not going to stand here and say that I'm absolutely categorically right, but it's from everything I've read and looked into, hindsight being 20/20, this is my view of it.
If your first point in the difference between the war in Iraq and the war in Afghanistan is going to be this is a legitimate war and that other one wasn't, I mean, I, you know, frankly, I can't imagine what your second point is going to be.
Well, I don't know
because I don't even want to try to guess at it because it's probably going to be more outlandish than the first.
You're cranky today. God, you're cranky.
You are. When I don't get my sleep, I get upset.
Yeah, you are just cranky. God.
No, you're kind of that kind of hit me the wrong way, I guess.
Well, I'm sorry if
I overreacted, but I don't like that because I don't think it was an immoral war in any way, but I also don't think that the administration sat down and said, "Let's pretend." It's insulting to my intelligence to think that the administration sat down, even if not, you know, overtly, and said, yeah, let's basically gin this up and focus on these WMD because the evidence is so overwhelming that contradicts that. In other words, there was such an overwhelming majority of people all over the world from different countries, from our own country, who didn't like George Bush and who were opposed to him, who agreed with that.
Well, here,
I just don't see how you can make that statement with a straight face.
I guess what I would ask you is, where were they getting this information from?
Obviously, from faulty intelligence sources.
Yeah. So, You know, so either
and there was a theory going around at the time also that Saddam Hussein had a vested interest in making people believe that he had weapons of mass destruction.
Well, sure.
And that may have had something to do with it too. I don't know.
So essentially what we're arguing here is that either they were incompetent or they were liars. You know, so, you know, I don't know. Both are bad in one way or another. If you'd like, what I can do is I can go back. I can dig up some books and take a look and build a case for my point of view. We probably have to table this right now because I don't have the stuff in front of me. I wasn't ready to have this conversation.
No, I don't want you to do any of that. What I want you to do is to try to have the debate without making, and frankly, and I think, wild statements about the motivations.
Well, so now I got to look this up, and I got
the Bush administration that you can't back up,
right.
and putting them across as fact. If that's your opinion, fine, that's your opinion. But when you say when you start out by saying, oh, well, the difference is this war is legitimate and that other one was phony and ginned up. Well, no, that's not a difference. You're sort of throwing that out there as though that's an accepted fact, and then I have to stop and say, wait a second.
Well, so
that's not true.
Well, then here's what I'll do. I'll go back and look and study a bit here, and I'll come back, and if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. And if I'm right, I'm going to stick to my guns, okay? Because I don't have the stuff in front of me. I can't pull it out right now and say, here's what I've read. Here's where it says right here, blah, blah, blah. Here's who's wrote it. Here's their sources, okay? But...
Excuse me.
But I will go back, and I'll do some digging here. Like I said, if I'm wrong,
Owen, I don't think that's necessary because I don't think we're...
You have impugned me, and I will not stand. My honor is everything.
I guess I'm misunderstanding. I thought your argument was that was your opinion. Now your argument is that actually is fact and that you think you can go find research that'll back it up?
Yes.
Okay, bring it on.
Yeah. Well, maybe I'm wrong here, but I don't think
bring
I am.
It on,
well,
brother.
We'll see.
Bring it on.
We'll see. This is awkward.
Aren't you exhausted?
No, I'm pretty good, actually.
Tired.
What we could do is, again, give Scott Walker the last word, and I've got a song by his called 30 Century Man, which is pretty good. We could end the show with that, if you'd like.
Isn't that the title of the documentary about him?
It is, as a matter of fact. It's also a song of his, and it's only like a minute and 40 seconds long, which I find really appealing, actually. There's no BS,
me too.
Just verse, chorus, done. Do you want to hear it?
Yeah.
All right, hang on.
See the dwarfs and see the giants. Which one would you choose to be? And if you can't get that together, here's the answer. You can freeze like a 30-century man, like a 30-century man. I'll save my breath and take it with me until 100 years or so. Shame you won't be there to see me shaking hands with Charles de Gaulle. Play it cool and saran wrap all you can. Be a 30-century man. You can freeze like a 30-century man, like a 30-century man.